Welcome to the YBMin lecture series offered by the Center for Asian Business at Loyola Marymount University in Los Angeles, California. This program is funded by a grant from the International Communications Foundation in Seoul, Korea. I hope you enjoy the program. Thank you.
A Maori greeting first, so tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa. My name's Leon Grice, and it's a privilege here to be at Loyola Marymount. And tonight I want to talk about free trade, but talk about it from a very personal point of view. And I want to start with when I was your age, what free trade meant to my family, what trade meant to my family, and then I'll talk about why New Zealand is probably the most activist free trade country on the planet. There are others, but we really put enormous effort into it. I'll talk about where trading patterns and the agreements across the Asia Pacific are at the moment, particularly now that TPP, the United States, has chosen not to be in the TPP, and I'll talk about what a little country is going to do in response, what our options are, and where the future is for us in terms of connecting with the world. So that's the topic. So before I actually get to my main speech, I always like to say, you know, we sit at the center of the Pacific. And most of the maps, off the maps, have us on the side, but we, all our maps, New Zealand's in the center and the Pacific is above us. And equidistant between LA and Beijing in the south is New Zealand. And New Zealand is the closest country west of LA. So everywhere else you have to fly further to get to. So we're the closest country west. But we sit really in the heart of the Asia Pacific. And one of the things I had to get used to when I came to Los Angeles was that when people talk about the Asia Pacific in Los Angeles, they mean China. And for us, the Asia Pacific means all of South America, the Pacific seaboard of South America, all of North American Western seaboard. It means North Asia, it means Southeast Asia, and more it's starting to mean South Asia. And so that's the way we see the world. So we're at the bottom, equidistant in the Asia Pacific, and that's our perspective. So catch yourself if you ever use China as a synonym for Asia Pacific, because it's a completely wrong-headed idea. I was born in 1963, I know, it makes me really old, and it was 10 years before Britain did its first Brexit. Its first Brexit was to leave the British Commonwealth and all the trading arrangements and to join the European Union. And I was arguing with Stu from our consulate here, Stu's here, we're arguing about in 1970, I think it was about 70% of our goods went to Britain and Britain alone, 70. Now, if you add up goods and services, that would probably be 50% of New Zealand exports. But can you imagine when all of a sudden your biggest customer shuts you out? And so their entry basically led to a great unraveling of our economic strategy, our geopolitical outlook, and it was a huge cultural realignment. When I was a kid, the last cultural moment really in our history, we were considered Little Britain in the South Pacific. And I think ever since I was a kid, we've had to realign ourselves and understand that we are part of the Asia Pacific and a bicultural country, partnership between the indigenous people, the Maori and the settler, the Pākehā, and also to increasingly today, an extremely multicultural country with 25% of New Zealanders born offshore. So we've been through this massive cultural upheaval as well as an economic upheaval. So when I was your age, we were extraordinarily pessimistic about our country's future. And it's only in the last 15 years that we've shifted from pessimism to optimism. It doesn't mean that 15 years ago things weren't good. It's just we went through 30 years of adjustment to actually get our economy back. When I was your age at university, the joke was, will the last person to leave New Zealand please turn the lights out? And so, but on the announcement that they were joining the European Union in the 70s and 80s, our politicians tried all sorts of things to buy time for the economy to adjust and for export businesses to find new customers in new markets with their goods and services. Their strategy was to close the economy from global competition. And we used protectionist measures, including import licenses, tariffs, export subsidies, industry subsidies, sounds like the farm bill, five-year plans, currency controls, price controls, wage controls, tripartite union negotiations, fuel rationing, including carless days, and high income taxes. The government protected all manner of industries, including car manufacturing, television set manufacturing, and clothing manufacturing. The Japanese TV manufacturers would joint venture with local manufacturers, and they would unmake their made-up television sets and ship them as parts to New Zealand to be made up again in New Zealand factories. So my family could not afford a colour television set, not for many years. My mother used to make all of our clothes, because my mother was a solo mother with five kids, and we couldn't afford the locally made clothes. Graham's up there in the audience. Wave, Graham. Graham was a leading executive in a clothing manufacturing business in New Zealand. So you can contradict me if you want to, Graham. But we couldn't afford the clothes. And imported clothes were so expensive, we just couldn't afford them. So New Zealand business people used to travel abroad. They used to sleep on the floors of New Zealand embassies because they were limited in how much foreign currency they were allowed to exchange before their business trips. This is in my lifetime, by the way, guys. Just remember this, okay? And inflation by the early 80s was out of control. And the productivity of the New Zealand economy was collapsing. The wage and price freeze put in place by executive orders, we call them orders and councils, failed as the implementation got more and more complex. Protected, lazy industries were not producing quality goods. And farmers were farming for subsidies and not for customers. And land grants were breaking in unsuitable land for sheep and beef farming, causing terrible conservation land damage. The productivity of that land was dreadful. By 1984, it collapsed. It was an existential crisis. At that point of change, was we kicked out a conservative government that was following economic nationalist policies. And we elected a left-wing government who won by a landslide. But they inherited a financial crisis, a run on the New Zealand dollar we couldn't afford to defend, essentially no foreign exchange reserves. They were completely depleted. Burgeoning budget deficits, a massively underperforming economy, a growing current account deficit, which is your trade balance, and skyrocketing national debt. The left-wing government, the Labour government of 1984, implemented a Chicago School of Economics policy program in the mid-80s. They immediately floated the dollar. They drastically cut all tariffs unilaterally. By the way, I'll stop there for a minute and just talk about unilateral cutting of tariffs. Most people talk about tariffs as I'll lower my tariffs if you lower your tariffs. The reality is the greatest gain is to lower your tariffs. Who cares what they do? And in the 1980s, I remember talking to our finance minister who said, if other countries want to subsidize their goods with taxes, I'm happy to import their taxes as long as they want to. And it was a really, for me, a key moment, which is if those countries want to sell cheap stuff to New Zealand, we can focus on what we do well and be subsidized by their tax bases. And so the idea that, you know, there is some trade, I mean, that's the way trade agreements get negotiated. It actually is an economic nonsense. So they abolished import licenses, they got rid of export subsidies and industry subsidies, and they opened the New Zealand economy up totally to global competition. The adjustment costs were quick. The car industry collapsed almost immediately. We started importing cheaper, better television sets. The cost of clothing started to plummet as we imported lower cost, high quality garments from around the globe. Farmers found new customers and new products and started adding value to commodities. Marginal sheep farms along the east coasts of the North and the South Islands sold to crazy people who thought that they could grow wine on that land. Today we sell $1.6 billion of wine around the globe, and the cost per hectare of the farmland and wine growing areas has grown from the $500 a hectare when it was just a couple of raggedy ass sheep on them to $20,000 a hectare. I could describe the impact on every single industry in New Zealand, but the general story is what survived thrived and today is booming. Input costs fell to global standards and our entrepreneurs focused on their competitive and comparative advantages and customers and not politicians and their subsidies. To prepare our workforce, we implemented a reform program in public education to ensure our high schools and universities produced independent, self-led learners with entrepreneurial skills. Today, our fastest growing exports are services and intellectual property sales, software licenses, management fees, and so on. Our strategy was to unilaterally reduce tariffs, and we put huge effort from the early 80s onwards into entering into free trade agreements to get access to as many markets as we could. So much so that we've become, along with Singapore and to a lesser degree Chile, the world's leading advocates for free trade and the establishment of free trade agreements. One of the problems you have in arguing for free trade is that the adjustment costs tend to be felt really sharply by defined groups of people, and it really smashes those communities, but the benefits are broadly felt across, you know, the economy in small degrees by everybody. And so when you're in the media and in the opposition, you tend to hear the people who are badly affected by free trade. My view on that is that's about the adjustment costs and how politicians invest in supporting people through that adjustment, as opposed to not having the greater benefit for all. So I made the claim about us being free traders. There's Wellington, where I'm from, by the way. It's pretty. This is the free trade agreements that we have in play today. So the first one was with Australia in 1982, and it's probably the closest trading arrangement in the world today. We operate very much as one economy, but unlike Europe, our sovereignty around regulations remains, but we work very closely to align our regulations. Now, 2001, two small countries, New Zealand and Singapore, did a deal, and we worked very closely with Singapore, and in 2006, we did the P4 with them, Brunei and Chile, the first across the Pacific deal. Now, that deal was, the chapters of that deal are the same chapters as TPP today. And then the most, in 2005, we did a free trade agreement with Brunei, Cambodia, Indonesia, Laos, Malaysia, Myanmar, the Philippines, Singapore, Thailand, and Vietnam. Its acronym is AANZFTA, ANZFTA. And then we did the biggest one that we've ever done and probably ever will do as a bilateral. In 2008, we were the first developed economy to do a free trade agreement with China. Two-way trade at that time was around $2 billion. It's now at $20 billion. 2008 isn't long ago. And the aim is, by 2020, to grow it to $30 billion in two-way trade. We also worked with the Chinese government to make sure that they would be relaxed if we did a free trade agreement with the territories of Taiwan. And so we now have a free trade agreement with Taiwan in 2013. And we completed the set in 2014 by doing a closer economic partnership with Hong Kong. We also, in 2010, did a deal with Malaysia, 2005 with Thailand, And the most recent one is a free trade agreement with Korea. Negotiated but not ratified, TPP, or the light blue up there, and the Middle East, we have a free trade agreement that we completed the negotiations with the Gulf states, which is a $4 billion two-way trading relationship with Saudi Arabia, the United Arab Emirates, Qatar, Bahrain, and there's other Gulf states that I can't remember off the top of my head. And that is likely to be ratified in the next few months. Agreements under negotiation. We had an oh so close, but we were literally about to sign an agreement with Russia, Belarus, and Kazakhstan. And Russia invaded Crimea, and our trade minister got ordered home, and his pen never hit the paper. And so we're hoping that that will be sorted out and we can get back to a free trading arrangement with those countries. There's an agreement under negotiation which requires enormous patience, which is with India. And then everyone in Indo-Asia is the RCEP, the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. And then we've got a free trade agreement we're negotiating with our cousins to help them, which is the Pacific Islands, we call PACER Plus. And we've just started entering into negotiations in preparation for a negotiation with the European Union. The French will be fine. Coming up after Brexit, we will probably move very quickly to do a high quality free trade agreement with Britain. Welcome back. And I'll talk about this a little bit later on. TPP minus one, maybe two, and I'll talk about the two. I see no reason why that is not going to go ahead. And the free trading arrangement, which everyone forgets, which is La Alianza del Pacifico, the Pacific Alliance, which is an incredible arrangement. We want to be first into that new arrangement and joining that free trade bloc. So that's how we trade in the world. By the way, you notice that New Zealand's in the centre. Now, before I talk about TPP and what might happen next, it's important to talk about why we're so committed to free trade. The answer is that free trade has been good for our businesses, and it's focused them on global markets. It has made them resilient, and they need agreements that are based on rules that protect them wherever they're going. And it's not just about lowering barriers like tariffs. It's about ensuring they're protected by a level playing field of rules and regulations wherever they operate. We're a small country, we don't have aircraft carriers, so we've got no hard power or ability to project hard power. We are all persuasion, international law, and soft power. After the Second World War, the United States led the creation of the complete financial and trading framework we all enjoy today, and it supported the peaceful rise of economies in the Asia Pacific and across the world. It was a rules-based order where trade disputes were resolved in tribunals on the rule of law. In those tribunals, the size of your army is simply not relevant. For example, we've taken WTO action against Australia, who keep preventing us selling them apples, and we win every time. Together with the US, we've taken the WTO action on Indonesia for beef restrictions, and we've won very recently together. The tribunals work. The rules-based system works. The US has been and is the essential country for the 20th century rules-based order. The US Navy provides security of sea lanes, guaranteeing trade throughout the Pacific, the Indian Ocean, and the Atlantic. Without that power, by the way, it's the first, the United States is not an empire, but in the history of the planet, there has never been an empire that has supported the trade of its competitors. And the US Navy basically keeps those sea lanes open for everybody and freedom of navigation. But the world and trade has changed. New Zealand is now focusing on expanding the rules-based order for the 21st century to encompass business not contemplated in the 20th century. We want new rules that protect the kinds of trade that until recently were never envisaged before, like the flow of data across borders. Likewise, we need rules for trade that create fairness, a level playing field, minimum standards for labour, protections for the environment, and rules that stop human trafficking. We need rules that protect intellectual property and investment across borders. The courts and the arbitration tribunals are where we want the rules enforced, and we want those courts to be fair. And we want disputes settled to protect the interests of 21st century trade. In essence, that was what TPP was all about. Despite what you might have heard, that's what's in the text of the agreement. The TPP, as I said earlier, started in 2001 when two little countries, we're 5 million, about the population, less than 5 million, about the population of LA City, and Singapore's a little bit larger than us in terms of population, agreed to a free trade strategic partnership called the P2. It was a remarkable agreement because its focus was much broader than normal trade agreements. The agreement included chapters covering intellectual property protection, environmental protection, labour standards, sounds like the TPP. Our two countries didn't need those chapters for our own bilateral trade, but it was our aim to develop an agreement that would be the gold standard for agreements in 21st century, a free trade agreement based on the rules of law and the principles of fairness. The P2 became the P4, and actually the agreement at that point was called the Trans-Pacific Strategic Economic Partnership to reflect its regional ambition. The Pacific Four linked Asia and the Americas together for the first time. In 2006, or 2008 in my script here, I think you've changed, we have to argue about which one it was. It was 2006, the Bush administration started reaching out in new ways to build greater partnerships and alliances across the world, post Iraq and Afghanistan. Susan Schwab was the USTR at that time, and she opened discussions with the P4 about the United States joining. From that moment onwards, the TPP was about US leadership, and it became a US-dominated agreement, and that's what we want. I mean that in a positive sense. With US interest, Australia, Malaysia, Peru joined, and then Canada and Mexico came on board, followed finally by Japan. Without the United States, it would never have anchored all those countries into the agreement. Our strategy of developing a comprehensive 21st century goods and services rule of law agreement had achieved two of our goals. The first was an FTA with the United States, something we realized after 30 years of trying was going to be too difficult to achieve bilaterally. And the second goal was a regional trade agreement backed by the United States, US power in behind a rules-based system. And we regard the United States as an essential nation in backing that framework. And I've always been an optimist about TPP. I thought it could pass in the lame duck, and I was wrong. But I don't rule it out in the future with the United States. But in the short term, I believe that TPP minus the US has every chance of being ratified and put into force. And the reasons why are, TPP stops nations using state-owned enterprises as tools to drive demand in their economies and drive unsustainable gluts in products like steel that leads to dumping. Dumping is the symptom of the problem. The cause is state-directed, state-subsidized, state-owned enterprises that are not regulated to behave like private business. China has an economy that is dominated at the moment by state-owned enterprises. And being able to regulate that and ultimately getting China to support China to reform is part of why we need those arrangements. I haven't put this in here. I really dislike the term balance of power because it's a very World War I term, and it just doesn't resonate with me about a accurate way to describe what's happening in the Asia Pacific. I don't believe that China and the United States are competitors in any way, that the way that was happening at the turn of the century leading up to World War I. But I do think that it is a balance of influence. And I think that the United States backing a rules-based order, a multilateral rules-based order, puts pressure on China in a positive way to reform, to make their economy more liberal, more open. And in doing so, China will become stronger and all of us will be better together. So I prefer the term balance of influence than this concept of balance of power. TPP requires nations to allow the free flow of data across borders, which is critical for e-commerce, innovation, and freedom of ideas. At the moment, there are countries that don't let data flow across borders because they want to censor data. They want to censor information. The TPP required, if anybody signed up, you had to allow a cloud-based software as a service to flow across borders to serve customers. The TPP is the first major trade agreement that protects the interests of workers. To be a member country of TPP, you must allow workers to form a union and for that union to be established with or without the permission of the government. Think about what that means in terms of the freedom of association and individual freedom. The TPP is the first major trade agreement that requires the companies of member countries to not sacrifice the environment to gain an unfair trade advantage, as well as committing them to not trade in endangered species. It's the first major trade agreement that requires countries to harmonize their intellectual property standards to increase protection. And of course, it lowers tariffs across most goods and services, aligning business rules and lowering the cost of export, which assists all companies, particularly small and medium-sized businesses. And that's, being a small businessman myself, that is a key to our success of our economy. And I used to think that the US was essential to TPP, and I've spent the last few years arguing passionately for US ratification of the TPP. And while the US is critically important, now that it's announced it will not do it, I'm not so sure that it is essential. And we've seen early signs from fellow TPP countries that support this. I think that Mexico and Japan, two large economies, have fundamentally strategic interests just to keep going. Japan needs to keep going with its three arrows of structural economic reform. Japan also needs to be an anchor for a rules-based order for trade in the Asia Pacific, and it knows it. Meanwhile, Mexico needs to integrate with the fast-growing Asia Pacific, and it needs to diversify its markets more than ever. Vietnam still wants to undertake legal and constitutional reforms to strengthen its economy and liberalize its society. The government in Hanoi has committed to a program of economic reforms despite the US exit from TPP. And Australia and New Zealand have strongly signaled we will keep going. I think all TPP countries will seriously look at ratification without the US. Japan has already passed the legislation, so it's already formally ratified the TPP. And once they do, I think Korea will look at joining. Why? Because we all need a rules-based system where trade disputes are resolved in tribunals and courts. We need a framework which places pressure on all nations in the region to undertake reforms to meet the standards in the TPP. They're tough standards. Free movement of data, strong courts, strong laws, market economies untrammeled by government enterprises, lower barriers. They are standards that will ultimately be important for reforms in China, positive reforms that will allow their economy to continue to mature, grow, and prosper. They are a target for them to reform. It might take them 15 years to get there, but having TPP in place allows for that target to be set. I have a list here of every country and what they've said on TPP. The only one that I doubt outside the United States is Canada, who never really wanted to be part of TPP, but it was unthinkable for them to not join TPP if the United States and Mexico were in. But I think, you know, we can convince them to stay in. It's just not going to be top of their agenda. I can come back to that and explain to it. So, trade trends in the Asia Pacific beyond TPP. Now, some people say the Chinese government has announced $900 billion worth of projects, and some are estimating that the One Belt, One Road is a $4 trillion project. Just to put that in context, that's the entire cost of the Iraq and Afghanistan war. And so, China is driving all the way through Russia to Western Europe with train links, oil and gas pipelines, and roads. They're going all the way through the stands and linking into their energy markets and those goods and services markets, again, all the way through to Western Europe. They're driving down through Thailand and Myanmar into South Asia and connecting to Bangladesh and India. into those Indo markets, down through into Pakistan, and right through to the Middle East and connecting with the African opportunity. Driving all the way down to Singapore, and what's not here is the infrastructure they're putting in place in the South Pacific connecting Australia and New Zealand. I'm going to a little bit of history, because I did a history degree. In 1941, FDR went on extended holiday a few days, and one of his cabinet secretaries stopped the sale of Californian oil to Japan. And the Japanese cabinet reviewed it and found that they only had 90 days of energy left to run their empire, co-prosperity regime. And so the attack on Pearl Harbor strategically was about taking the Americans out so they could drive south to Indonesia to get the energy they needed from the Indonesian oil fields and coal to actually continue to run their empire. My view is that, and it's not, I don't have any intelligence on this, but I think it's self-evident, the Chinese will understand that they can never control the Pacific. They can never dominate the Pacific. The Pacific is always going to be a balance of influence. But the One Belt, One Road means they can drive west. And what that infrastructure means, and all along those routes will be bond houses where you don't have to pay tariffs until you release your goods. So there'll be not only are they roads and rail, not only are they sea ports and airports, but there'll be bond houses and infrastructure that support trade. And if you think about the supply chains around the world, and you think about those connections, it's lowering the friction of trade right across Eurasia and down into Africa and South Asia. That is the most single biggest trend in trade today, and it's not going to stop. In fact, if any contest, if there are punitive tariffs put on China, I believe China will just double down on this as a national project with a national sense of urgency. So I can't think of another project, another single. And, you know, there's a lot of argument about whether or not this is economic and whether or not those projects are viable. But I don't believe that really matters in terms of where the Chinese are investing for the future. So everyone talks about TPP being dead, but, you know, RCEP, the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, which includes basically all of the Southeast Asian countries, India, China and the North Asian countries of Japan and Korea. Everyone talks about that as an alternative to TPP. It's not. It lowers the barriers to trade by lowering tariffs, but it doesn't address any of the rules-based infrastructure we need for the 21st century. And New Zealand will be an active, supportive negotiator, because we're part of the agreement with Australia. We'll push as hard as we can to get the RCEP across the line to lower some of the barriers that we need to trade successfully in the Asia Pacific. But RCEP and this together is one of the futures. You simply can't talk about the RCEP agreement without remembering that this investment is going on today. So what does New Zealand do? Where do we go from here? Well, we keep pushing on the TPP minus one, and we keep making the case to the United States that TPP is a positive thing, and TPP is better with the United States in it. We will be following our interest and our interest alone in terms of any bilateral opportunities. The Trump administration talks very enthusiastically about bilateral deals, and there'll be lots of them. So we'll look at it. If there's a high quality deal that's on offer, we'll do it. If it's not high quality, we won't. We'd prefer not to do a deal than a high quality one. All our deals that we do are high quality, and we'll focus on the countries that want high quality agreements. I think the Trump administration is interesting. We'll be watching very closely the first bilateral, which is probably going to be Britain. And they've talked about it being a high quality agreement. And I would have thought, in terms of all the bilaterals that they need to do, that they will carve that out as a template. And so there won't be much negotiations outside the template that is done between Britain and the United States. But that's 2 years out from now, because you know Britain really can't legally, it can talk about what could happen, but it can't enter into legal negotiations until it has formally left Brexit, which could take at least 2 years. So probably the, you know, it might be the first bilateral, the US may do other ones in between times, but we're gonna be looking very, very closely at those bilateral deals and what they mean for New Zealand. We'll probably do, as soon as Britain is free, we'll do a free trade agreement with Britain. And the other ones, I'll go back to the list. For us, our trade strategy, which is being, I'm not party to it but at the moment because it's being redone, but we'll go back to the, we'll make sure that the Gulf agreement is done with the Arab states, and we'll move on to the this list here, particularly the European Union. The European Union has given themselves a deadline of 3 years to complete it with New Zealand. And then finally, everyone forgets it, but the true free traders, the Pacific Alliance, is an incredibly exciting agreement. And we've made no secret of the fact that we want to join, and our negotiating terms are we agree. So as soon as we're working closely with Colombia, who are worried about their agriculture sector, we're now starting to invest significant amounts of New Zealand money and know-how to bring their agricultural sector into the 21st century. What's happened in Colombia is that huge tracts of land have been unavailable for development because of the civil war there. And so they want to get modern development going in terms of their agricultural land. And so we're working with them to not fear us as competitors, but to see us as partners in the development of their agriculture. And once we've got, I think, their confidence, that'll be the last piece in us joining the Pacific Alliance. There are direct flights from Buenos Aires to New Zealand, which are full. They've been very, very successful. And we're getting Spanish. I'm so pleased my children have been learning Spanish here in LA, because Spanish is going to be one of the key languages for New Zealand in the future. So I'm going to take questions now, but there's one other thing I'd like to say about, which is sort of economics. And it's a very simple principle. The reason you export is so that you can import. And the reason that you import is so that you can export. You know, imports are not bad. They are good. And so the other thing I'd say is that you can be in a trade imbalance. New Zealand runs trade surpluses. But you can be in significant trade imbalance. We're in trade imbalance with Germany, for example. It's a fantastic trade imbalance to have, because we get access to their light manufacturing technology, their robotics technology. We get access to some of the finest engineered agricultural machinery. And what does it do for us? It makes us a much more productive economy. It makes us much more competitive. And so when you hear that people talk about trade imbalance as a bad thing, it's voodoo economics. The reason the United States is in trade imbalance is because you're rich and you can afford to buy the best products for wherever they're from. Now, that doesn't mean there aren't dumpings and there isn't unfair trade going on, but as a principle, we export so we can import, and we import so we can export. That's the simple economics of it. So I'm just trying to give you some simple economic ideas to inoculate you against economic nationalist thinking. Okay, so that was the final lesson of my childhood as well. And having lived it, and having lived the transformation of our economy and my prospects, my lifestyle, my career prospects, it's free trade that has got us to where we are today in New Zealand. I think the US is totally committed to freedom of navigation, and that's absolutely crucial. And the trade will continue. It's just You know, the trade's not going to stop under Trump. It's going to continue. What will happen is that other trade flows will happen in a less friction, and it just sort of starts going that way, and the trends just start moving. So the United States isn't going to stop being the central and most important economy in the Asia Pacific. Well, you know, we have a trade specialist trade division. So the ministry has called Trade and Economics Group, and inside that is the Trade Negotiators Division. And we have people with 30 years of experience on how to negotiate. And so typically what you'll do is you'll do a scoping study of what the impacts of two-way trade are and what the opportunities are, and you'll come to some rough consensus about what is and what could be. And then from there, the trade negotiators will identify what they call chapters of addressing that. And they'll start taking, there are texts around, there'll be WTO texts. So the World Trade Organization text will become templates because you want to do it within the WTO so you can resolve disputes within the WTO style mechanisms. You know, you don't need to reinvent the tribunals. And then from there, what you'll do is that in a negotiation, you'll say, well, here's our text, and then for, let's say, the free movement of data. And then another country will say, well, here's our text. And you put square brackets around them, and then you'll try and merge the two texts together somehow or come up with another text. And that will go through. What they'll do is trade negotiators will every 6 weeks meet, having strategized, got more information, talked to politicians, and then consulted with industry, consulted with the community, typically in New Zealand. And then slowly and by surely, you get less and less brackets. And it always comes down to the tough things at the very end, which is, you know, there's so much opportunity on the table, you're prepared to do the tough things. And then finally, the trade negotiators go, right, we're done. We've done as much as we possibly can, and the ministers, the politicians come in, and the politicians, as we all know how to do dirty things. And that's when basically the final deal is crunched. So that's the process of how you do a free trade agreement. Then it has to go into force, then you have to pass laws to match it, so you're enabling that agreement, which is, by the way, you are giving up that piece of your sovereignty to do that. That is true. But that's a good thing. And then from there, you need to educate your business community, educate the community to make sure they take full advantage of the new rules that are in place. If you look at what China was saying while we were negotiating the TPP, because the negotiations are complete, we're just waiting for countries to ratify it. China was, you know, one part of China was saying, how dare the United States try and contain us? At the same time, another part of China was saying, this is good. This will help us transform our economy to a services-oriented economy. And so there are people in China that know that they actually are going to need to go through that reform process, and this becomes a target for them. And Xi Jinping himself said that they would look and investigate TPP to join it. It might take them, it took them 15 years to get into the WTO. It could take them 15 years to get into the TPP. I mean, things like the free movement of data are going to require it's a considerable challenge to the way the Chinese Communist Party operates. The only official study on it was the Peterson Institute, and they said, you know, it would create 130,000 jobs and add, you know, X billion dollars to the economy, which was a pretty weak outcome, actually, for the United States. But, you know, we thought when we signed the free trade agreement with China in 2008 that it would grow from 2 billion to 8 billion, and we thought that was that was our analysis between New Zealand and China, two-way trade. And we were absolutely excited about that as a number. And, you know, as I said earlier, it's now at 20 billion heading to 30 billion. So I think it's very difficult to econometrically analyze the wins, the benefits from free trade, but from our experience, they always exceed the outcomes. So, and I think in the United States, being such a large economy, it'd be hard to, as an individual level, to feel it. I think the, so what I mean by that, to feel the benefits. NAFTA, without question, has been a juggernaut of growth for the United States economy and put the United States at the center of incredibly powerful supply chains integrating Canada and Mexico. Without the United States would not be nearly as successful economically, in my view. But it's very hard to demonstrate that to a worker who's being laid off in Pennsylvania. And I think if you look at the Trump support, it had nothing to do with free trade. I mean, coal, you know, the coal regions, that there's nothing, there's no trade barriers that are driving those jobs out of being economic. It's cheap gas, which is driving, you know, Kentucky coal out of business. It's going to be very difficult to subsidize them back to competitiveness. The US is awash in natural gas. And steel as well. I think that there are arguments for that the US, it's cost the US the way that China's operated its state-owned enterprises. So I think there is an argument there. And I think that that has to be dealt with through the WTO mechanisms, you know, the anti-dumping mechanisms. But, you know, I didn't think the TPP was going to cost the United States a single, you know, there'll be swings and balances and adjustment costs, but I didn't think it was going to cost the US a single job. I'll talk about Canada for a moment. Canada protects its agricultural industries with supply management, which controls what is supplied into the market, and politicians set prices. And so Canadians pay, you know, four times for milk what you pay, and it's bad. And same with pork and chicken and production. And when you look at those farms, 50 cows will get you $1 million worth of subsidized income a year. So the Canadian taxpayers will pay someone who owns 50 cows $1 million a year, right? And the way that they're farming is 1950s technology. Why is Canada doing that? And the answer is because they're rich. Madness is bad for consumers. You know, kids like me who are, you know, raised by solo mothers who couldn't afford it, you know, would be directly impacted by the high cost of those foods. So, you know, that those are real impacts. So the US can afford, it's a wealthy country, it can afford to trade with itself, the 50 states. And it can continue to be wealthy for quite some time, and probably will always be wealthy given the resources that it's got. It can be more wealthy. If I look back at probably the best sales of free trade in the United States, it's people like Bill Clinton and Joe Biden who went into the workers and talked directly to them and said, yeah, it is going to change. The world is going to change, but I'm going to be standing by you and helping you adjust to that change. Now, whether or not they delivered on their promises or not is another matter. But I think, you know, the reality is, you know, what did we do in New Zealand with adjustment costs? 5% of farmers went bankrupt. There was chaos, absolute chaos. 5% is a large number, 1 in 20. But fortunately, it was a left-wing government that didn't give a tinker's cuss for the rural votes. So we had a left-wing government implementing Milton Friedman's playbook and was able politically to ignore, couldn't really, but it, you know, it could have ignored those rural votes. And within 3 years, the rural voters were their biggest supporters because their input costs went down and their returns went up, the ones that survived, but there was that adjustment cost. People who worked in the car industry, car manufacturing industry, lost their jobs. So what do you do? Well, in New Zealand, we have cradle-to-the-grave welfare. And so there was never, people were never going to be, you know, they're going to have their lives up, you know, terrible upheaval. But our biggest investment in to cope with adjustment costs was bipartisan left-wing, right-wing governments, heavy investment in education, and heavy investment in reforming education to make sure it delivered people with 21st century skills or 20th century skills when I was a kid. So I think those are the fundamentals. And, you know, if you don't, have a decent strategy of helping your economy cope with adjustment, then you're never going to get free trade across the line. But what I would say, it's not free trade. I mean, the biggest risk that you're going to face in your career is the adjustment costs from automation and robots. Right. How are you going to survive as politically aware and politically active leaders of the future? How are you going to... That's a much bigger threat, much bigger than free trade. How are you guys going to make sure that your society hangs together and develops the skills and capabilities of coping with that adjustment? I think it would take a long time for China to make those reforms. I can't see that in the short term, but if China makes those reforms, we would welcome them in with open arms. Absolutely. By the way, the reason I'm so... Japan got itself into an economic strategy hole and couldn't make the structural reforms in many industries that it needed to re-energize its economy. You know, and so Prime Minister Abe came in with three arrows of tax reform, labor market reform, and the third was structural reform through free trade. Prime Minister Abe sat down with our Prime Minister in 2011 and he said, we want to join TPP and we're going to be really tough to negotiate with, but what I want you to do is never back down. He needed an exogenous threat to continue on with his reform program. He needed, we're going to be left out if we don't make these reforms, as the platform for him to motivate the parliamentarians and the community to accept the structural changes that the Japan economy needed. Same thing's happening in Vietnam. Those are the things, those are the really positive things, I think, that come out of TPP. And I think at some point, the Chinese are going to have to bite the bullet and think, we need to move to a services economy that requires the freedom of data and all those sorts of things. And TPP becomes that exogenous target. If we're going to, you know, be a wealthy economy, we have to have this set of business rules. So I'm very optimistic. It's going to take time, but I can't see us not getting there with the way business is going.